Are you ready? Let's dive into our study and pray that I make it without crying. This is a very difficult scenario, and it's a very difficult reality that we deal with in today in our own churches, and so it's just hard, you know. So I ask for forgiveness now. If I lose it, I don't mean to lose it. It's just a very difficult thing. Anyhow, as we've been going through the apostle's letter to the Corinthian church, and we've been examining it, we have to be careful. Oh, and I do need to say this as well. The topic is a sensitive topic. So, yes. So if you don't want your little ones to hear, just letting you know, they might be better off in the children's ministry, just so you know. It won't bother me if you get up in the middle and take them over there. But we have to be careful as we go through this letter and we examine it. Because what can tend to get lost is that these were real people. You know, this was a real church and dealing with the real issue that was tearing them apart. And of course, this was just one among many issues. But so far as we've seen in this letter, there was division in the body. There was this ongoing debate of, you know, for leadership among them. And worldly values were being used as wisdom in these debates, and it was resulting in this spirit-filled believers acting like unbelievers. And now, as we saw last week, there's sexual immorality among them, and the challenge before us as we go through this letter, again, is to, you know, put ourselves there, right? Imagine if these issues were happening in our own church. It's one thing to read these things, these letters in black and white. It's quite another thing to put names and faces to these issues. And so this church was devastated. Our church would be devastated. The question is, you know, how do you survive something like this? Could we survive something like this? And how do we handle these issues? So we've examined how we should think and respond to division. We've examined how to think and respond to carnality. And now we see how we as a church should respond to sexual immorality. So the title of the message today is Responding to Sexual Immorality. So look at verse 1 again in 1 Corinthians 5. The Spirit inspires the apostle to write, "It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and such sexual immorality as is not even named among the Gentiles, that a man has his father's wife." So last week, again, we answered the question, what is sexual immorality? I felt like that was important to address first and to define, because the decisions made from that point on will be based on what is sexual immorality. The phrase here, sexual immorality, used in 1 Corinthians 5:1 and in Acts 15 at the First Jerusalem Council and many other places in the New Testament in the original language, is the word porneia. And it covers a wide variety of sexual acts. So when Paul and the Jerusalem Council, when they use the word porneia, the basis for what determined what is porneia, sexual immorality, it comes from the law that God had given to Moses. And we find that in Leviticus 18. We find that in the Ten Commandments. We find it, you know, in various places throughout the scripture. So now we see what the egregious sin was in the Corinthian church, because we've been studying this book line by line, verse by verse, going through, starting at chapter 1, verse 1, and we now find ourselves at this stage here in the book, and we now see what this egregious sin was. It was an incestual sexual relationship between a man and his stepmother, which was strictly forbidden in Leviticus 18, verse 6 and verse 8, God says this. He says, "None of you shall approach anyone who is near of kin to him to uncover his," I would say her, "nakedness. I am the Lord." And then in verse 8, he says, "The nakedness of your father's wife you shall not uncover. It is your father's nakedness." Now, also the word here strongly, the wording here strongly suggests, and everyone I've read agrees, that this was an ongoing relationship. So it wasn't just a one-time thing, and it was obviously going on even while Paul was writing this letter to the church. Now, it's not told to us how this became known, but it is widely known. And what is just as egregious as the sin itself that Paul is about to address is how the church was handling this situation. So look at verse 2. Paul writes, "And you are puffed up and have not rather mourned that he who has done this deed might be taken away from among you." And if you look at the beginning of verse 6, Paul says, "Your glorying is not good." So we're going to stop there for a moment. I just want to say to you that in my personal experience as a believer and as a pastor, when something as drastic as this is taking place in the life of a believer, they usually end up removing themselves from the fellowship long before the sin becomes known. Again, in my experience, when someone removes themselves, that usually ends up being the first sign that something is not right, that there's something wrong in their life. It's not always necessarily a sexual sin, but in this case, it is. And in many of them, it certainly can be. But if a person does not remove themselves and they do nothing, and then the sin comes to light, as Moses told the tribes of Reuben and Gad in Numbers, but if you do not do so, that is, if they do nothing, he says, then take note, you have sinned against the Lord, and be sure that your sin will find you out. And so what was the church's response to this sin? Listen now, and please hear my heart in this. And I will say this, I believe every situation has to be handled with tremendous prayer, with tremendous care and gentleness and love. I do not think that there is a cookie cutter response, if you will, for all of them, so to speak. I think that every situation is different, and every situation has to be handled with wisdom, counsel, and prayer. However, we do use the Word of God as our basis for, you know, how we do respond, and this is what Paul is saying. So here's what I want to say to you. The worldly wisdom that was being used back then that this church was struggling using is the same wisdom that is being championed today, which is tolerance. It is tolerance. Instead of removing this person from the congregation and applying biblical discipline until repentance has taken place, the church was tolerating the sin, and they were allowing this person to stay in fellowship. Paul says that they were glorying in it. That is, they were proud of the fact that they were accepting this person or this couple. And by doing so, they thought that they were being loving. Yet the Spirit says to the Apostle Paul that our initial response should be to mourn and then to remove. To mourn and then to remove. To mourn, that is, to mourn for the people who are involved in this particular sin. That is, to mourn for the family who is being, you know, devastated over this particular sin. That is, there's a lot of things to mourn for. Mourn over the difficult situation that they have put their family in, they've put their friends in. Mourn over the difficult situation they've put the church leadership in. Mourn over the fact that this brings a reproach now upon the church. Mourn over the fact that this brings a reproach upon the name of God. And understand, there is a difference between being sad and mourning. I think most of you understand that. Mourning is a deep, deep sorrow that you have when something very precious has been lost. And so many times it's mourning, a lack of appetite accompanies mourning because you just can't eat. You're so devastated. You just can't even think of eating. Mourning often results in a life change. I would say in an unexpected life change. And that mourning can last for a very long time. And understand there are many deaths taking place here as a result of this sexual immorality. There's the death of innocence that has taken place. There's the death of character that is taking place. There's a possible death of friendships, right? If this ancestral relationship didn't kill the friendships, it certainly changed it. Probably, who knows for how long. So mourn, the Spirit says, and then remove. Now, the reason I think many believers struggle with the idea of removing someone is because they've been taught, or they've heard, I would say, some faulty teaching in regard to this. They will say, well, doesn't God accept me for who I am? And hear me out now. The problem with that statement is that they're confusing a couple of things. They're confusing the moment that we come to God for the first time versus now being in an ongoing relationship with God. That person who says, well, doesn't God just accept me for who I am? I would say they're confusing salvation with sanctification. God accepts the sinner, yes, and thank God he does. Amen? He accepts us, warts and all, sin and all. The scripture is true that God demonstrates his own love toward us and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And, you know, the idea is that when we understand that truth, when we hear that truth for the first time, man, that it's overwhelming. You know, that, yes, Lord, I was in absolute rebellion to you. And while I was shaking my fists at you, you died for me. And I'm here now and I'm saying, Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for my attitude and my prideful heart towards you in that regard. But listen now, once the sinner is accepted and is now a child of God, the expectation from God is that we sin no more. That we no longer live in a consistent manner of sin. Jesus said to the woman caught in adultery, at the moment of her salvation, when all of her accusers left the scene, in John chapter 8, he says, woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you? And she said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. And then he says, go and sin no more. So, absolutely perfect response, biblical response. Our goal is not to condemn anyone. But the expectation is that we are to go and sin no more. The Spirit says through the Apostle John, we know that whoever is born of God does not sin. And that's a difficult scripture. I think a lot of people have misinterpreted that scripture. One Bible commentator says this. He says the present tense in the Greek verb there implies habit, continuity or an unbroken sequence, meaning once that we are born of God, we do not keep on sinning. That is, that we don't keep living a consistent lifestyle of sin. We don't live in a continual lifestyle of sin or a continual mindset of sin. Look at the rest of the verse in 1 John 5. It'll be up on the screen. He says, but he who has been born of God keeps himself, and the wicked one does not touch him. So that is once that we have understood all that our sin has cost the Father. Once we understand the incredible love of Jesus to pay for our sins, that God the Son became a man, that he was born of a virgin, that he lived a perfect life, he endured ridicule and shame, he was beaten to a pulp, he was nailed to a cross, he shed his precious blood for the first time ever in his life, he was separated from the Father, he was buried, he rose again, all so that we may be saved from the power of sin, that we may be, the bondage of sin may be broken, the power of sin may be broken over us and in our lives, and then the sting of sin has no effect on us. He now gives us his Holy Spirit to keep us. He makes us born again, as I was saying last week, where the Spirit now dwells in us. We now have a new nature, and hear me out now. Either that is true, either that is a reality, or it isn't. You can only fake being a Christian for so long. Either you have a new nature or you don't. And when we stay in the Word, we stay in his love and of this mindset, this is how we keep ourselves. As it said in 1 John, but he who has been born of God keeps himself. This is how we keep ourselves. John records Jesus teaching us, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So now, by his mercy, by his grace, and by his incredible love, we live, and we no longer live a life of continued sin. Does that make sense? Now, hear me out now. To accept a person's sinful lifestyle and to allow them to stay in the fellowship of the church is the world's wisdom of tolerance, but it is not the biblical instruction. From God's perspective, to tolerate sin is to hate the individual. To love the individual is to discipline. The writer of Proverbs says, chasten your son while there is hope, and do not set your heart on his destruction. God doesn't want this sin to eat you or this other individual alive, because that's what will happen if it goes unchallenged. It will eventually consume this individual and destroy both body and soul. So now we look at God's discipline. Look at verse 3. Paul writes, for I indeed, as absent in the body, but present in spirit, have already judged, as though I were present, him who has so done this deed. Now we're going to stop there for a moment, because someone might be saying, well, doesn't the Bible say not to judge? And what is the answer, everyone? Yes and no is the answer. The context of the Lord's commandment on judging is not to judge, but it is a warning to be careful of the measurement that you use with which to judge. Does that make sense? So Matthew 7, Jesus says, judge not that you be not judged, for with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured back to you. So yes, we need to be extremely careful. We need to be very prayerful. We need to have lots of wisdom. It's also a warning not to judge hypocritically. The Lord goes on to say, and why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye, and look, a plank is in your own eye? Hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, but listen, in order to do that, there has to be judgment. You have to judge properly. Then you can clearly see to remove the speck from your brother's eye. So Jesus will later on instruct the people and his disciples to use righteous judgment. He says, judge with righteous judgment. That's a scripture that a lot of people don't know is in the Bible, that Jesus said. So, well, didn't Jesus say judge and won't be judged? He also said judge with righteous judgment, right? That's the whole idea. We are to use righteous judgment, using the right basis for judging, and not to judge hypocritically. Paul is using righteous judgment and instructing the leaders of the church to do the same. And so look at verse 4 in 1 Corinthians 5. He says, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of our Lord Jesus. Now, what does that mean? I'm going to stop there. So here's what I want to say to you. This is not a proof text to be mean, and it's not a proof text to be weird. This is language that is given so believers would know how to think, what is happening spiritually speaking when this is going on, when discipline is being administered. This language is not given in order to call someone up in front of the whole congregation. Could you imagine? And yell at them, and somehow like we're now channeling Paul's spirit and we're yelling at them that, you know, we're turning you over to Satan. Can you imagine? That is not what this is saying to do. And I'm going to have more to say about that in a moment. But listen, the most loving thing that we can do is to turn this person, whomever this person is, over to the instruction of God, to God's instruction, so that he, that is God, may discipline this person. I would say not us, but that God disciplines this person. Now, certainly this can become difficult if this person is a minor. This person is your child, and he lives or she lives with you. Then the discipline will have to be administered by the parents, and maybe with the help of, you know, some loving brothers and sisters, very wise brothers and sisters. We have to be very careful about that. But whether this person is a minor or this person is an adult, the protocol of Matthew 18 should always be followed. So if you mark Matthew 18, turn there, and we'll read through this. Some of you are very familiar with the scripture. Picking up in verse 15, Jesus says, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth or of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. So if you find out, or if you know that someone is engaged in sexual sin, what should you do? Well, what you should not do is go around telling everyone that you could possibly think of. What you should do is take that person out, sit down with them one-on-one, person to person, and ask them. That's what we don't want to do. What we want to do is we want someone else to do it. But the scripture and Jesus is very clear. We should speak to that person very respectfully, very privately, and pray that they hear you. And in that situation, then, you know, you've won them. You know, and if they want help at that point, then, you know, if you don't know how to get them help, then you, I would say, seek counsel from, you know, someone that you trust or church leadership to help them in that situation. If they don't hear you, then what do? Then I would say you go to the next person that they love and that they care about, who cares for them, and you talk to them. And then you too would then go and talk to this person. And we try everything that we can to reason with them. And if he refuses or she refuses to hear them, verse 17 says, tell it to the church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. So the difficulty becomes if this person says to you, listen, I don't care what you say. I don't care what the Bible says. I don't care what the church says. I don't care what God says. It's a very difficult thing. And so what do you do in that situation? Well, Jesus says here in Matthew 18, verse 17, I think is essentially what Paul is instructing the Corinthian church, the leadership to do. And it's to deliver this one over to Satan. Jesus says, then let him be to you like a heathen or a tax collector. Why? So that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. So that for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved. Now, when the Spirit of God speaks of our flesh, understand he speaks of our sinful nature, not our physical body. Certainly, you know, the Spirit through the Apostle Paul is not instructing us to do any physical harm to anyone. And he's also instructing the person who is in sin not to do any physical harm to themselves. There would be no self-harm. But as Paul says in Galatians, that the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, that word again is porneia, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in times past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. So what is to be destroyed here, again, is not a person's body, but a person's sinful nature that is controlled by their self-will. I've said this before. The Lord wants to destroy our self-will. And he desires that we would destroy our self-will. I am actually looking for Philippians. You know the scripture. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking on the form of a bondservant, coming in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above all name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, of those in heaven and those on the earth and those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus, that we humble ourselves to the point of death, even the death of a cross. It is God's goal, everyone, that our self-will would die. It's in his prayer, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory and the power forever and ever. It is your will to be done. Not my will." That was the Lord's prayer in the garden. "Nevertheless, not my will be done, Lord, but your will." The Lord wants to kill our self-will. He wants us to surrender it to him. When we deliver a person over to Satan, it means that we deliver him or her over to Satan's domain. As the Spirit says to the Apostle Paul in Ephesians, "In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, being treated as an unbeliever, let him be to you as a heathen or as a tax collector." Means the child of God, understand, we're talking about a child of God, comes out now from underneath the protection of the body of Christ, like the prodigal, and is let go, so that they may get their fill, if you will, of the world, that they may see how utterly sinful the world is, that they may remember how much God loves them and come to their senses. At some point, come to their senses. And that's not easy. It is not going to be easy. That is probably one of the most difficult things that we can do. And it's going to be hard on everyone involved. So what do we do in the meantime? Listen, we pray. We pray. We believe in the power of prayer. We pray that they don't do any physical harm to themselves. We pray that they become disgusted with their carnality. We pray that the Holy Spirit haunt them and disrupt them, and, you know, whether it be a vision or a dream or a word, it could be anything that someone at work says, even an unbeliever might say, right? It could be the fact that one day they just open the door and they walk outside and God just overwhelms them. They can be in the most perverted place, and God could speak to them in that place. psalmist says, where am I to go that you are not? Even if I go to the depths of hell, behold, you are there. The Holy Spirit, Billy Graham called the Holy Spirit the hound of heaven, that he goes after us wherever we go. We pray that they would have a godly sorrow and not a worldly sorrow. Right? The Spirit later says through the apostle, for godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted, but the sorrow of the world produces death. And that brings up a whole other thing I don't have a whole lot of time to go into. But listen, tears don't equal repentance. You know, I've had many people in my office when they're going through difficult things and struggling, and they're crying and they're broken down. You know, you just have to let them cry, let them get it out of their system, and then when that's over, I have said to people, "Look, I'm glad you're crying, but you need to understand this is not repentance. Repentance is what are you going to do from here on out." How are you going to turn your life and surrender to the Lord? And what steps are you going to put in place? Repentance is real work sometimes. It also brings up the whole idea of being careful that you're not allowing whoever this is, if it's a spouse or if it's a child, to emotionally manipulate you. Because godly sorrow brings repentance. Worldly sorrow leads to death. And this is not an easy thing. It's a very, very difficult thing. Let me give you some other scriptures to kind of help build your understanding here of the Lord's discipline. Moses tells the nation of Israel in Deuteronomy, and get this now. He says, you should know in your heart that as a man chastens his son, so the Lord chastens you. The writer of Proverbs, my son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction, for whom the Lord loves, he corrects. If you have Hebrews, Mark, turn to Hebrews chapter 12, another very familiar scripture. In verse 7, the Spirit says to the writer of Hebrews, if you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons, for what son is there with whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Get that. Listen, I'm not saying that. God is saying that. And so when we're dealing with the person who is lost in sexual sin and their heart is hardened, they hear that. It's like, you know, it's offending their every pore. Well, this is just who I am, and this is just what I, you know, believe. Verse 8, but if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. And that is the goal. The goal of discipline is for the sinner to love God again, to remember God's love, but according to how God has revealed himself, according to God has revealed his will in the scripture, not how we think God is, not how we what we think God's will is, because a lot of this dealing with sexual immorality is actually very plain. It is very black and white. There's not a lot of gray. Anything short of loving God as he has revealed himself is idolatry. It's making up God whom we want him to be, how we want him to be, in our own image, in our own likeness. And since the Bible is our final word of authority, the Bible is our final word of authority. Is there a final word of authority in your life? Are you the final authority in your life? Or is God's word the final authority in your life? Since God's word is the final, I want you to know, you need to know, in this church, God's word is the final authority for me and for all of us. Because here's the thing, 9 times out of 10, when there's someone in the congregation is in this kind of sin, they remove themselves. You know who doesn't remove themselves? It's the leadership of the church. And the leadership of this church has to come underneath the authority of the word just as much as anyone else. And I guarantee you, the board that we have, if I'm in sin, will kick me out. Remove me. And discipline me as they should. The Bible is our final word of authority. And if we want God's results, listen, if you want God's results, we must surrender to God's instruction. So, we know what the sin is. We've seen the church respond. Through the world's wisdom of tolerance, we have heard the Spirit's instruction to mourn, to remove, and to deliver one over for the destruction of the flesh. And next we see the Spirit's warning of influence. Look at verse 6. He writes, "Your glorying," this is back in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 6, "your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened." Leaven, as most of you know, is a picture of sin and the influence of sin. And so every year, Paul brings up this picture of Passover. Every year at Passover, the nation Israel was to go throughout the whole entire house and remove leaven from the house. I mean, they turn up everything you could possibly think of and clean the house. Believe it or not, this is where actually the whole idea of spring cleaning comes from. It comes from this. So the Lord's instruction was given in Exodus 12. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread, but on the first day you shall remove leaven from your houses. Leaven, sin like leaven, takes time. But it eventually affects the whole lump if it's not removed. This is precisely what happens when we don't properly surrender to the Lord's instruction on how to handle sexual sin in the church. If we tolerate sexual sin, it will prove to be as leaven. Its evil influence will eventually corrupt the whole church if it's not removed. The Spirit reminds us in verse 7 that indeed Christ is our Passover. He was sacrificed for us. Jesus was our Passover lamb who was sacrificed for us. Therefore, he says metaphorically, verse 8, "Therefore, let us keep the feast not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." So not with malice or wickedness, but unleavened with sincerity and truth. We worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, Jesus says, for our Heavenly Father is seeking such to worship him. We worship him in spirit and in truth. How can we expect to remain in the very sin that Jesus died for? My brothers and sisters, that's an evil way of thinking, and it cannot be. How do we respond to sexual immorality? Well, we do not respond in the world's way of thinking with tolerance. We respond with mourning, with removing, following Matthew 18's protocol. If need be, handing them over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh in the hopes that their spirit may be saved. But we cannot allow the influence of sexual sin to remain in the church. We cannot do it. It's a very difficult thing to talk about, but let's pray. Father, Lord, we thank you for your word.